Well, now that means I've got to learn how to tell myself what to do, doesn't it? One of the things I've been telling myself to do lately is to ride the trains and the buses. I told people when I was traveling in the East there in December that if the shooting started, I was going to park that thing. My car doesn't run on blood. So I went up to the Northwest, and to get around, I put together this patchwork of, short line buses and Amtrak and carpools where I had time to develop them. I guess the cinders in the stew is that I couldn't use a Greyhound because I wouldn't ride on a scab bus, but I got around pretty good. You see, and it's something I should have been doing all the time anyway. We had the best transportation system in the world in this country. The spider web of trains and the interurbans and the trolley cars when we spent a lot of social time being together. And that was all junked for the sake of what Ken Kesey calls these little motorized coffin. We want all of those things back right now. We gave them up far too cheap. And I don't like to fly. For one thing, those things are heavier than air. They can't fly. Fool knows that. The reason they do fly is a kind of a collective act of faith. Everybody up there believes that thing can fly. If one person looked up from their in-flight magazine long enough for a light to go on in their head and said, wait a minute, this thing can't fly, it's heavier than air, it'd drop like a brick. And of course, there's a notion that everything in that airplane was built by the lowest bidder. Whew, that'll bring you up short. Well, this last time I flew was to Chicago, and it was better than most, not that the food had improved or that I felt any safer. But I was sitting on the aisle, and across the aisle from me was an older woman, quite an old woman, a nun, wearing a black and gray nun's habit and a big wooden cross around her neck. And she was reading the Sojourner's magazine. Some of you must know that magazine. Meanwhile, the two young bravos sitting next to me, with their short hair, were on their way to Kentucky for basic training in the Army. A situation fraught with possibilities. Well, now, age has its privileges, so she got first crack at it. And she, in an elegant but a stern way, called those young fellows to task for their rather primitive notion of Christianity. I never had any other notion myself. Then it got to be my turn, and of course I couldn't take them to task for enlisting, because I enlisted. I enlisted in the Army and then got pipelined to Korea, the land of morning calm. I told them the same thing I told my son Duncan when he came up to Spokane coming out of high school. He was thinking of joining the Marines on the buddy system, which he did. I told him the same thing that I told him. We sat out under my lilac hedge in the backyard, and I talked to him. I said, you know, the only thing I really learned in Korea was that I will never again abdicate to somebody else my right and my ability to decide who the enemy is. Might be I wouldn't have to go thousands of miles to find him either, and that's a fact. And then I sang him a song I made for him. I had never talked or sung about Korea much at all. Let's see if I remember it.